Hello, everybody. Happy Christmas. This is Felie Fred Velez wishing you a very Merry Christmas and a welcome to Plastic EP's Facebook Live party discussing the Monkees Christmas Party album. And we'll have a wonderful panel tonight. So if everybody feeling groovy, let's get groovy.
Hey bananas, you think you're groovy? Hey bananas, we watch a movie. Drive your June buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. Love to watch you cause your favorite show.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey bananas,
hey bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey bananas, we think you're groovy. La na 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 na.
Hey.
Hello.
And we've got Natalie over there.
Happy Christmas.
Merry Christmas. And we got Mark.
Hey, Merry Christmas.
Mark.
I got the Christmas party.
And we got Michael.
Hello.
And we got
Santa
Charles.
Santa Charles.
And we got Plastic EP. We got, and he's going to be unwrapped for Christmas.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
We just want to unwrap him for Christmas.
We're going to unwrap him for Christmas.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Plastic EP live album show. Today we'll be doing the Monkees. I love the Monkees. Don't you love the Monkees, guys?
Hey.
That's why we're here.
It is groovy.
We're here because we care.
We're ready to go on the Plastic EP live album show. And look at this. The human wrapping paper. How are we?
Hey. Hello, we're going to wrap you now.
That's it. And if I need a drink of water, I'm okay.
There you go.
This is great.
Is that what, that's your mask when you
go
out?
Do you see that cracker? Do you see that cracker?
Yeah.
I just cracked it open. You get a free hat in it.
Wow.
I remember the
yellow one. I don't think you can see it.
No. Hold it in front of
your face. There it is.
It's like disco. Burger King.
All right, listen, everybody, we're going to get into the show. Fred, show us those albums again. I want to see the albums.
Okay, Fred, say hello to my.
What's that monkey doing? That's hello, great. I love that. Friend. That's fantastic. You can sleep with that. Yeah. Show me the albums. Guys, who's got the albums? What do you got to show me before we start?
There you go.
You got the this is the this one is the candy cane version.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Oh,
what's that, Charles? Is that a reindeer? Is it?
It's
a chihuahua.
It's someone got excited when they saw Fred's pet monkey. He wants to meet him.
Yeah. I got the boring black version, you know, but
sounds the same.
It's like a reindeer.
Yeah. I think it's a chihuahua, but it looks like a reindeer, yeah.
I got the record store day double single, which is also in color vinyl.
Oh, pretty.
Uh-huh. And
the album also has a little paper insert, which
is just a just before we start.
And the Target CD, which has the two extra bonus cuts.
Yes.
That's what I got.
Around my place, we're playing two other songs. I'll have a blue Christmas without you.
Fred, do
and
you
we
have
the other one? Santa, bring my baby home to me. Back home to me. They're my two favorite songs.
Sorry.
Which one, Mark?
Do you have the original Christmas is My Time of the Year single from the 70s?
Yes, I do.
Oh,
cool. I'll try and grab that one when I get a moment.
Okay.
Have you noticed something I'm flashing? Why am I flashing? Look, I'm flashing.
Oh, yeah?
Why am I flashing? I can't understand. I must come, be coming down with something.
Do you have lights in the room?
There you go.
You're all flashy.
I'm flashing too, and I'll strobe you.
I got Davey's new Christmas album.
Yay.
Yeah, put that right up to the computer. Bring it in.
Right.
We love Davey, we love Peter, we love Mickey, and we love Mike. That's great.
Yes, we do.
I have a Christmas album called Beechwood Christmas, which does have Peter Tork on it.
Oh, nice. Right.
And I have Peter Tork's.
Hey, 7-0 Records. Everyone go out and buy 7-0 Records.
Yes, we will.
And Fred, you reviewed that album. Isn't it great?
And I love the album. It's wonderful. And it's a great tribute to Peter. It is. It is a good album.
Okay, fantastic. Now, we're going to start with the first song.
Wait a minute.
Santa Claus. Wait.
Don't I always start the show with a song?
I'm sorry. But Charlie's not here.
So?
All right, start the show with a song.
I'm going to start the show with a special song that I actually wrote in the hopes Davy Jones would someday record.
Ah.
All right? So I'm just going to give you a snippet of it. You ready?
Yeah.
What's in mind?
Don't you take me to a little town. Don't take me to a place where life's like a merry-go-round and around like a tease. Take me to the place because it's Christmas Eve. Oh, take me to a little town. Don't take me to a place where life's like a merry-go-round and around in a tease. Take me to the place where I want to be. And that's good enough for now.
Thank All right, you. Listen, is everybody having a groovy time out there?
Oh, yeah.
No way. We're going to do the first track, which is called Unwrap You at Christmas. So I want everybody out there in the world to watch carefully my face. Are you watching?
Uh-oh.
Here we go.
Gross.
Am I?
Please put it back. Put it back.
Oh, my goodness.
Hey.
Thank you. What do you think of the first song, Unwrap Me for Christmas, Charles?
First, I wanted a fire engine. I got this.
What do you think of the first song?
Written by Andy Partridge of XTC, who I love. I love XTC. So, guys, this sounds like it could be a Christmas standard forever. When I was DJing a few years back, I was playing this in the middle of, you know, rocking around the Christmas tree and Jingle Bell Rock and people coming up, wait, what is this new? What is, they didn't know what it was. And I said, you know, this is the Monkees. It's their new Christmas album. And they didn't, yeah, come on. No, I love it. I love it as much as You Make Me Laugh and Here Comes the Summer off of Good. It sounds like Good Times Part 2 with a Christmas theme. It's a great pop song in its own merit. It's a great chestnut of a Christmas song. It's bouncy. Davey could have sung it too. And, you know, it's a hit. I introduced it to a lot of radio DJs, and they didn't even know the Monkees had a Christmas single out. And I said, play this. And they did, and it got great response on the air. You know, it's great. Mickey's great on it, the production, the musicality. Everything about it is a 10, 10, 10, 10, 10. I love the song. Natalie.
You sure?
Okay, so this is the first time I'm actually listening to this album all the way through. I did not know that there was a Monkees Christmas album before this, so I have a bunch of notes prepared based on what I heard and based on what it reminded me of. So just to give you guys a bit of context of where I'm coming from with this, so Unwrap You at Christmas is a great start to the album. Very upbeat. It's sweet. It's romantic. It definitely has a falling in love vibe during the Christmas season. In a sense, it kind of reminded me of the song Don't Answer Me by Alan Parsons Project, in a sense, because of how melodic it is. But overall, I thought it was really enjoyable. And if you look at the lyric video for this, that also kind of matches the overarching theme of it sort of taking inspiration from Alan Parsons' Don't Answer Me, because that also revolved around sort of a comic book motif. And the way that that video was prepared, it also has sort of a comic book motif. If you look at the lyric strings inside of the thought bubbles in each of the panels, this is one of those lyric videos that kind of revolves around that idea. So I think that's what it also reminded me of visually. But overall, great start to the album.
Fantastic. Come in, Fred, and watch my lips don't move. Come on.
There you go. It's a great album opener. It was Andy Partridge who wrote it. Again, it does sound like a continuation of Good Times. I think that's, they knew they couldn't do Good Times 2, so they thought, let's do a Christmas album instead. And I think it works out very well. Mickey sounds great on it. It's because of the circumstances, the year was recorded, the other two surviving monkeys couldn't be on it. It was a very, you know, because Christmas albums are usually recorded like in the summer, and then we know the circumstances that happened with Mike and later Peter, so that's one of the reasons why they couldn't be on tracks together. But it's a monkey song. I mean, it's not any different than what they recorded back in the 60s, like the first two albums and later albums later, you know, forward on. But it's a great tune. It's a great, like I said, it's a great way to start the album.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Come in, Michael.
Thank you. One of the good things about this album is when they got people to write songs for them to sound like the Monkees, which is one of the great things about Good Times. The best songs are the new ones that were written in the old Monkees style. I love this. Andy Partridge wrote a Phil Spector type of Christmas song, I think. I actually made the comment one time on Twitter, I wish Andy Partridge had written all the songs because I'm such a big fan of him. And he actually responded back and he said, I would if they'd let me. So I Twitter. it's a great song. I love it. I love Andy Partridge, and it's a wonderful way to start the album. Absolutely.
Yes.
Mark.
All right. Well, let's just mention the songs he wrote for Good Times. He wrote You Bring the Summer, which was the hit, or one of the hits off Good Times. And he also did Love's What I Want, which was just one of the bonus tracks that he happened to write. I remember when he was on Zilch, he had talked about a third track that he wrote, but he didn't say what it was. Well, I think it turned out to be this Christmas track. So he was already actively involved, but he couldn't talk about anything at the time. And yes, like what Michael said, he'd like to do more. So very good opening to the album. Andy Partridge and XTC can continue to write or do anything they can to promote the Monkees. It's great.
Fantastic. Fred, can you tell me, are you running on electricity or are you running on solar today?
I've only got 5 watts. I'm not that bright.
Fantastic. Now, the next track, Wiz, What Would Santa Do? What would Santa do, Santa?
What would Santa do? Unbelievable. Hook. What a hook. This was written by one of the guys from Weezer, probably their lead guy.
Yep.
It's more modern than Unwrap You. It's a great, great Christmas song. I mean, we got two killer Christmas songs in a row, two great Mickey vocals in a row. And, you know, when I can't play this album, or I'm going to be singing these two songs in my head for weeks. I mean, Unwrap You, happy, joyous. What Would Santa Do? Amazing, infectious hook. And it's in my brain, and I'm hearing it over and over right now.
It's in my brain.
On my brain.
What would Natalie do?
What would I do? That's a good question. Okay, well, anyway, What Would Santa Do? Another great follow-up to the first track. The beat has a very Taxman-esque vibe to it. It at least reminds me of Taxman in a way, in terms of the bass. It's got a very pretty chorus. I love the melody and the lyrics. I love the cascading harmonies throughout this track. And it kind of reminds me a little bit of the song I Saw Mommy Kissing Santa Claus in a way, based on some of the lyrics and for the later verses, but overall, it's a great follow-up.
Hey, Natalie, what's in your hair?
Oh, this old thing?
Is that mistletoe?
Oh, it's a bow. Fuck you. We gotta have mistletoe for Natalie.
Broccoli, like
Ed, what do you think of this song?
It's a fun song. It's a great second song to follow the first one. Mickey again sings this great. It's a fun little tune, and it gives you some things to think about. You know, what would Santa do in these kind of situations? But it's a wonderful follow up to the opening track.
Fantastic, Michael. What do you think?
Well, if you look at my record collection, you'll see XTC, Oasis, Fountains of Wayne, and Weezer, and a bunch of other bands, all of which why I was so excited about Good Times, because some of my favorite writers were doing that album, and now they're doing this too, obviously. I'm a big Weezer fan, yes. And so I think this is a great song. Oh, my God. You know, it's like two wonderful songs in a row. If the whole album was this good, I would be playing it constantly and never put it down. You hear these two first song, and I remember when I first got the album going, oh my God, if the whole album was like this, I'm going to be so happy. Unfortunately, it's not, but I play this one over and over again constantly. It's wonderful.
Right. What do you think of it, Mark?
Well, let me point out, Rivers Cuomo wrote the other big hit off of Good Times, which was She Makes You Laugh. So they definitely did the right thing. Adam Schlesinger, God rest his soul, definitely did the right thing of getting Andy and Rivers back to doing two good tracks that have very creative and different type of lyrics than what you typically get on a Christmas song. So very happy, very strong opening, and thumbs up all around. So
fantastic. Now, I've got a few texts. We're going straight in it. We've got a great friend of the show. We absolutely love him. Ron Dainty. There he is.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Hey,
Ron. Hello, Ron. A big kiss for Christmas.
Don't go away, Ron.
Hey, Natalie, can you send him a big kiss?
I love the album, Ron. I love it.
Yay. Thank you, Ron. Thank you.
Now, I just want to say, show us that again, please, Fred.
It's the Archie's Christmas album with Ron and Betty and Veronica. How about that?
Fantastic. Let me also tell you something else. Ron Dainty has got a double CD out now, right? Have you got that there, Fred?
I got it. Here we go, Ron.
Bring it right up and show everybody what it is. I want everyone to go out there. It's the number one selling double CD for Christmas 2020. And this will be the biggest selling double CD for 2021, sorry. Fred, show me a bit of it. Can you show me the CD? Because I haven't seen it.
Okay.
Explain to us a bit about it. Come on.
It's a double CD. What I like is that they recreated the calendar label, which is fantastic.
Right. And also, they've got a bit of writing there. Show us the inserts and show us the back cover.
Okay. Just a second. Here's the inserts. Very nice. Picture of Ron right there.
Yeah, bring him right up. Bring him right up to the screen so we can see Ron. There you go. Everyone, can you blow him a kiss, Natalie? Blow Ron a Christmas kiss.
Hey. I'll blow him a kiss too.
We love Ron. Ron, thank you for
love Ron.
We love Ron.
Oh, and here's look at this. This is on the second CD, and it looks like one of the
cutout albums from the
cutout. The cutout record.
Right, exactly. Very clever.
So go out and buy that double CD. It's about 46 tracks. 17 of the songs have never been released. He's got everything in there. It's unbelievable. Let me tell you, the only thing I can say is sugar, sugar,
honey.
A buying frenzy for this and my two books.
Calendar Girl was done. Calendar.
Calendar Girl was Don Kirshner's hit, so he named the label Calendar.
Ron, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Ron, we love you. That's from the Sugar Pops box.
Oh, wow.
CD, that's the cereal that you cut out.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Thank you.
Love you, Ron. Merry Christmas.
We love you, Ron.
Merry Christmas, Ron.
He's the greatest.
Let's throw in a quick one. We have to go see Ron. Throughout the year, hopefully COVID is not going to affect it. He's touring with Happy Together, and he's booking a lot of great dates all over the place. So we'll be seeing Ron.
I hope we'll see you soon.
Yeah, and we're going to get Ron back on the Buzz Show because Robin and I love the guy. We had a great time last time, and it's only getting better. And look, you just got to love the guy. He's just one of the greatest music legends out there.
with the biggest selling song of 1969 around the world, and he hasn't stopped. And listen, how great is it that he produced Barry Manilow? I can't get my head around all those great, fantastic songs that live with us every day. So go out there, buy Ron Dainty's double CD, get the Archie one, and make sure you go out there and buy all the other albums that he produced.
Go out in a buying frenzy, and don't forget my books.
This one that actually has been written by Ron Dante.
Yes.
Yeah, we just call him Ronte. We can get Ron Dante, but yeah.
Here we go from Robin B, who I do the buzz with. Hi, Charles Rudolph, or Santa, or Rudolph.
Yes, Robin. Yes.
The red nose throws everybody off.
Father Time.
Father Christmas. Anyway, Nat, who's next?
Okay, Charlie, the first one we'll get in. Watch.
Third song. We're getting ready for dinner.
Merry Christmas, Charlie, everyone. Charlie. Okay.
Christmas, Charlie.
Okay, the third song, let's keep it moving, is, tell me if my pronunciation is correct. Meli Kalikamimaka.
Yeah.
Come on, Wanalea.
What do you think of that song, Santa, with a big red nose?
Guys, this was written in like 1949. Crosby had the first hit with it with the Andrews Sisters.
In
1950. But I didn't really know the song that much until the Davey version.
Oh, shame on you.
Really surprising because I'm this music guy and DJ, and I probably heard it but never really gave it much thought. And when I heard Davey's version, I was like, oh my God. You know, I want to touch on what somebody hinted at about the first songs being so amazing, wishing the whole album, keeps up, but we'll get to that. I think the album continues to be great with this song. I mean, you listen to it, and God, it sounds like Davey's alive and with us. It sounds so modern, so well produced, and perfectly sung. God, I love it. I love this song so much. Now we've got three in a row that are just as good as anything, that's ever done in so long. You know, I have a favorite Monkees list from pre-70s or whatever. And then I have my favorite songs from the 1980s on. And I got to tell you, all these three first songs on this album might go on that list. I like them all that much. Onward.
Hey, can I tell you something, Santa? If you grab your nose, can you take it like out 3 inches and just let go of it? Let go of it.
No.
Oh.
You lost your nose.
Oh. Red nose day.
Okay, Natalie, what do you think of this song?
All right, so Meli Kalikimaka. This song is a lot of fun to listen to. It's just silly. It's enjoyable. It's definitely a Davey-heavy song. It kind of reminded me of the Annette Funicello song Pineapple Princess because of that Hawaiian flavor overall. Namely because of the name of the song and that it's a cover revolving around that phrase, Meli Kalikimaka. And I could certainly envision Davey dancing to this particular song as he's performing it. So overall, it's just enjoyable.
Fantastic. I've got to say, well done. 10 out of 10 for pronouncing the song right. Now, I've got to ask you, Fred, before you start, are you plugged into AC or DC power?
He goes both ways.
Right. Okay.
That is a good question.
Fred, don't electrocute yourself. Just come on in and tell us about that song, Kalak and whatever.
Fred doesn't like it. Don't worry.
No, I get a charge out of it. So,
Can I ask you why you like every single track we ask you to review? I've noticed that I like it. All I hear is every song, no matter what it is. It's good, bad, indifferent, weird. You go, I like it. Do you like this one?
Yes, I do. It's okay. What's not to like? Mm-hmm. It's a fun little song. Davey sings it well. It was a hit not only for Bing Crosby, but also was a hit for Don Ho back in the 60s. So he was the other big
song. Hang on a minute. Ho, ho, ho.
Ho, ho, Don, ho, ho, ho. But it's a fun little song now. I like the one that's in the Christmas party, but I think I like the one that's in the current Davy Jones Christmas album that Mark has over there. Because it's been remixed by Chip Douglas. Yeah. And I believe that Coco and Mickey Dolenz are singing backup vocals on that. Definitely in some of the songs. That'd be an album that we could discuss also. But I like both. This album, this song was released on Davy's 1990 Christmas album, Christmas Jones. And that's the one that the remix that's with Chip, that Chip Douglas did. So there are different versions of this, of the songs. And as much as I like this song, and I do like it, there are some other songs on the album I wish they could have used. They could have done a third Davy song on this album. And I wish they did. But it's a good song and it's fun.
Fantastic. Now, Michael, are you wearing a tie? Michael, what is it about you today that brings you in the line with what we're doing?
It's a wrapping tie. I should wrap it around my face, perhaps. You know, that might be better.
Don't wrap it around your neck. Make sure you don't wrap it too much around your neck.
I got green in the background and a red shirt. How's that?
He's awesome. Santa's got his nose back on. Now, what do you think of this song?
He's also wearing Christmas boxer shorts, but only I know that.
That's right.
Okay. What do you think of the song now, Michael?
I would have loved it if the entire album was all new songs, but that's obviously impossible because you have Davy. Of all the songs for Davy to pick, this is such a perfect Davy song because it sounds like a monkey song. I mean, it could have been a monkey song, and it fits so perfectly. He sings it well. It's very predictable. But that's okay. That's exactly what Davy is very good at, and it's over quickly. I mean, it's only 2 minutes long or so. You love it, and then when it ends, you go, boy, that was a great song. You know, you kind of want more. So three great songs in a row. I can't be happier.
Right.
Now, let's move on to Mark. What was that joke you said before? Are you Elvis, are you? Mark, did you say you're Elvis?
Anyway,
you don't look elfish.
When we wrote our second book, Headquarters.
Yeah, show us. Headquarters. Put up the screen and tell them where they can buy it.
You can buy it from Bear Manor's website. You can buy it on Amazon. You can buy it through Barnes & Noble. Any place that sells quality books like this.
The chipmunk book, where's that?
Oh, it's somewhere here. I can show it to you. You mean this?
Yeah, that one. Yeah, tell me, Charles. What's your favorite chipmunk song, Charles?
It's the Christmas one, of course.
And the chipmunk song.
I still want a hula hoop.
Okay, what do you think of the song, Mark?
So on this song, Mecca Lecca Hi, Mecca Heiny Ho. If you watch the movie National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, which a lot of people do, they play the Bing Crosby version. So if you want to hear it without scrambling around on YouTube, it's in that movie. Anyway, I still don't know when this stuff was recorded, Charles. I mean, do you know? Because he put out Christmas Jones in the 70s, and then it's Christmas Time Again in the 90s. And then it's like this now, and it seems like Chip Douglas just loves to redo it, revise it, remake it, and everything like that, which I have no problem with. But when was it originally recorded?
1990, I believe. His White Christmas came out like 77.
So some of the tracks were done.
Yeah. The tracks are earlier.
Okay. So anyway, that's all I had to say about that. I love that track. I loved it a long time ago when it was just Bing Crosby and the Andrews Sisters, because I had some old 78s, and I don't have it with me right now. That had that on there. I said, what a cool song that is. You know, it's like, anyway, so thumbs up. If you're going to do an old track, do an old unique track. Don't just do the same old Santa Claus coming to town.
Right. We are all in agreement so far. You know that?
Yeah, but I'm just waiting for Fred to say that he loves every single track on the whole album.
I love Christmas, so that's
fine. Make sure you don't get a shock there, Charles. I'm a bit worried about the electricity. Now, Track four, House of Broken Gingerbread. What do you think of that, Charles?
Okay, you know, I love it. Not as much as the prior three. It's got great, great instrumentation. I don't find myself singing it. It's not a hook chorus song. Like, if the first three are AM songs, this might be the FM song. If those are, you know, hits, this is an album track. You know, the others were AM friendly and sing along. It reminds me of Pictures of Matchstick Men. Do you know that song, guys?
Yeah, of course I know that.
Yeah, it's a little darker, you know, a little not as up-tempo and monkey-ish, but it's a great Mickey vocal, and it belongs on the album. It's a great original song. I love it. Not as much as the other three.
Status Quo put that song out, didn't they?
Correct.
There you go, ding, ding. What do you think of it, Natalie?
Okay, so House of Broken Gingerbread. This one was really pretty to listen to. Has a very English vibe to it in terms of style. It's definitely driven by the harmonies overall. It seems somewhat inspired by Rubber Soul and Revolver in a way. There is a lot of originality in terms of melody overall throughout the track. I really, really did enjoy this particular one. It just seems to be getting stronger with each additional track as it goes on. And this is no exception. So great track overall.
Fantastic. Come in, Fred Velez from the Electricity Factory.
There you go.
Fred, you like it?
I like the song. It's just, it's a different type of Christmas song. It's not a, it doesn't convey a joyous atmosphere if you look at the lyrics. Right. The lyrics is basically Christmas as seen from the eyes of a child in the middle of divorced parents. And if you look at it from that viewpoint, it's a different perspective on the holiday of Christmas. Like, this kid is torn between two parents who want to celebrate Christmas with him, but, you know, it's not a united front anymore. It's two different families, and he's caught right in the middle, and the song and the lyrics convey that feeling. So it's a totally different Christmas song. It's not one that you would sing as next to Here Comes Santa Claus or something like that, but it's unique, and Mickey sings it well, and you could feel the poignancy and the pathos in this song, you know, along with its joyous music, the instrumentation.
Joyous or joyous?
Counterbalance to what the lyrics are.
Joyous.
That's fantastic. It. What do you think, Michael?
This is actually my favorite song on the album, but that's a tough thing to meet, because they're, when I say favorites, like, the others are 10s. This is, you know, this is a 10, the others are 9. So it's not hugely favorite. It's written by Adam Schlesinger, did the music, and the words are by Michael Chabon. If you know Michael Chabon, he is a famous science fiction writer.
Wow.
All kind of awards. He writes for Star Trek Picard right now. He wrote the lyrics for it. And so you get these two together, and it's just a great song. It's very catchy musically, and the lyrics make me interested. Let's put it that way. Other Christmas songs sometimes, happy, it's Christmas. You know, this is like, hey, these are interesting lyrics. I like this. So it's my favorite on the album.
That's great. What do you think, Mark?
I like it. I love it. Because, you know, probably for the reason Michael loves it, I don't as much because it's a little bit dark. But it's still a good track because it's well written. And, you know, hey, Michael Chabon, why not? To continue with the Good Times Connections, Adam helped co-write two songs. One was Our Own World, and the other was I Was There and I'm Told I Was Having a Good Time. So he co-wrote those for that album. So he gets the Monkees. He knows what works. And, well, unfortunately, like I said, he's passed on. But, you know, it's what made Good Times and this Christmas party brilliant. So,
fantastic. Here's a question for you, Asana, Charles. Read that out.
Charles, I saw some words on your hat. What are they? Oh, man. I don't want to show it.
Bug.
That did it. I'm getting rid of this one.
Hey, you look good. I like that. Can I ask you, is that the Hugh Hefner party hat?
The furry one. Yeah. Hey, can anyone else put their foot up, their leg up, like I'm doing? Is anyone else like a yoga expert?
You're not dancing there, are you?
Let's dance on with my foot right here. Let's dance on.
Now listen, while you're doing that, can you explain the picture behind your head?
Thank you for asking. So we had an artist commissioned to change the Pool It album into a Christmas theme. And Mickey's got a green one. Davey's got like this wooden soldiers pointed elf one. And Peter's got a 3D one. And it's just a nice juxtaposition of Christmas in the pool with them. You know, it's not my favorite album, but I love this picture. Thank
hey, can you take it off the wall and put it up to the computer? While you're doing that, I like this comment right here. You guys are too much. I love that.
Hi, honey.
All
too much.
Danny,
too much. Yeah, bring that right up. That looks great.
Closer, closer, closer.
Move Davey up a bit, will you?
Let me look.
There's a pool party right there.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's summer down in Australia, Plastic, so you get to go to the pool while we get snow.
Yeah. So I'm going to explain something to you. Here, the Melbourne weather is funny. It's been raining for the last 3 days. Honestly, it's been raining.
Oh, boy. I hope you'll be all right.
No, I'm all right. I'm inside.
Okay.
I've got my canoe near the back door in case I have to go at the shops.
Do you canoe?
No, I don't. Do you?
No, I canoodle.
Thank you.
Zulus,
Merry Christmas.
Oh, I usually win.
Fantastic. We're going to move on to the next track, but I just want to say, here's a couple more texts. Hi, Mickey. How are you? He's a big supporter of the show.
Hey, Mick. I hope you're feeling better.
We got Charlie DaCosta keeps sending us messages. Charlie, you should be on the show, not texting me.
Charlie can tell us who's playing what instrument on every song.
Right.
I've got to say something there, Charles. You're looking more like a king now. You're looking like a king on the throne.
Now I'm King Wenceslaus.
You're King Wenceslas.
I thought it was Hanukkah Harry.
Right. The next track is the Christmas song. What do you think of that?
Nesmith as a crooner? Really? Yes! It's great. You know, the song was written by Mel Torme, who was like this loungy, you know, cool, quiet, you know, relaxed. That's what this is. It's a lounge. It's a great version. Torme, Perry Como, that's the vibe it's given. You know, you think, well, the Christmas song was done as a standard. So many people have done it. Why is he doing it? Why? Because he does it great. My God, it's a great vocal. It's Nez at his best slow song. I just love it. And, you know, there's that little touch of country guitar in it that really, you know, brings it all home and makes it, you know, a Nez song. But here we are with Chestnuts Roasting on a song number 5, and it's as good as the others. And wow, Mike Nesmith, you're on the album and you're great. I love it. And we're at 5 in a row, and this is where the Christmas album pretty much ends. But anyway, moving on.
Thank you so much, King Santa. Now to you, Natalie.
Okay, the Christmas song. Now, this is a standard that most people do covers of around the holidays. And Nesmith's cover is no exception. It is great. The way that he approaches the song is just brilliant. When I first heard this version of the song, his version, this thought came to mind. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire in Hawaii or Southern California. That's the vibe that I got from his cover of the song. There's some really pretty ooh harmonies in the chorus. It's just a gorgeous cover overall, and it definitely has that country vibe because Nesmith was influenced by country rock. And that's definitely, I just lost my hair. I just lost my present bow. I'm going to have to fix that. But overall, love his cover, love the approach that he took. And I was immediately drawn to it right away because it's Mike Nesmith. So on that note, I'm going to reattach my bow.
Okay, while you reattach your bow there, what do you think, Fred?
Fred, that's me. I always liked the song itself. It's always, it was a very nice song. As Charles says, Mel Torme did it. And it to me, it doesn't really sound as much as a Monkey song as a First National Band song. But it has that that pedal steel guitar slide that was very famous with the first National Band sound. And it's Christian Nesmith and Nez's sons are playing along with his band from his solo tours. So, like I say, it sounds more like a first National Band song than a Monkees song, but Mike does a great job with it. And he's the one who picked it as his inclusion on the album. You know, they said, you sing whatever Christmas song you want. Okay, I'm going to sing this one. And he did. And it's a wonderful version. And it's too bad that the Monkees weren't touring this year, or they were touring like around December. They could have added some of these songs on the set. Mm-hmm. But this was a great version. It's always been a great tune. But it's Nez just brings it a notch higher.
Fred, did they ever do any of these songs live in any of the concerts?
They did Ryuchiu with Mickey's Christmas show a couple of years ago, 2014. I was at that show. Michael didn't make it, right? Was it you, Michael, or was it Mark?
It must have been Mark.
Mark.
Oh, no, yeah, right. This is the one that you talked to me about, and I didn't even know about it until after it was over. And I said, how did I miss it? Right. Down near Philly where I could have gone.
But Mickey done Ryuchiu live. He's done, he might have done, there's probably some songs on here that, I don't know. None of these songs I recognize as being in the set that he did. So Davey might have.
I think Peter played Angels We Have Heard on High solo.
I think so.
He's got it on one of his albums.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I think Davey did do White Christmas or something like that in one of his December shows.
But I was talking about Unwrap You or... You know,
No. They did.
None of the new ones.
No.
Okay, Michael, what do you think of the track?
Well, I'm gonna say that Mike does a great job. I love his singing. I think this is a good performance, but I'm disappointed because we don't really need old covers that we've heard 100 times. I mean, it's a good version, but I would have loved to hear something new, especially from Mike Nesmith, who hasn't written a new song in like 20 years. I mean, he hasn't done anything new except the one song on Good Times, you know, and then they covered a Circle Sky, you know, on Justice. Where's Mike? Why isn't he writing anymore? I'd love to hear an original song from him. So I'm disappointed because I wish he had done something else. It's like, oh, great, another version of this song that I've heard 5 billion times that everyone else has done. Yes, it's done well, but give us something new. That's why I'm disappointed. This is when the album starts to go downhill for me.
Well, just to counter that, Mike Nesmith has recorded solo stuff. He just hasn't recorded anything new for the Monkees.
He doesn't give it to the Monkees. That's all.
He hasn't had an album in quite a while.
Raise was the last album he had, and he put out
a long time ago. Yeah,
and he put out some stuff on his some downloads on his
on video
ranch site. So there are new songs out there. It's just that. Okay. They haven't been out.
All right.
Oh, they're not out in CD.
I didn't realize there was new stuff on Video Ranch. That's my mistake.
Okay.
And let me also say, you want to buy some great Michael Nesmith stuff? Go to Rick Video Ranch.
Yep.
Check out what he's got. He has got fantastic stuff there. We love you, Mike. Okay. What do you think, Mark?
You can even do a podcast with Michael Nesmith if you pay enough. Anyway.
Right, Mark, what do you think of the song?
I like it. I think every Christmas album has to have a few old standards. It's like, I mean, it's a bit grandiose to say, let's make it all new, because then you're really inviting comparison to Good Times. But apart from that, I'm glad that Michael didn't change the lyrics like Paul McCartney did, because they said turkey. And I like it that Christian, Michael Nesmith are on there, and Cersei Link and all the people that tend to tour with the Monkees. So, you know, at least it was kind of connected in that way. I know it's the first National Band too. And so I like it. I don't love it because it's not my favorite song. You know, I tend to like the original Mel Torme version. It's fine. But I wanted to say one thing about the album since I'm on this page. It's like Mike Allred, great artist and comic books and things like that, did the album cover, but they also interspersed, if you have the booklet, little images of the Monkees throughout the booklet. So it's worth it to actually get a physical media instead of just downloading these tracks. So.
Fantastic. Let me tell you something, Charles. as this show progresses, you're looking more and more like Santa. I just thought I'd say that.
Look at my ear. Hold on. Watch this.
The man is talented, I tell you.
Rudolph the red-eared.
That's talent right there. Now, we've got to move on to the next track, which is called Christmas Party. Are you having a Christmas party at your house, Charles?
I'm having a Christmas party in my pants, brother.
There's a party in my pants. Then
and they'll all be singing Let's Dance On from the Monkees first.
Got a party in my tummy. Got a party in my tummy.
All right.
Let's talk about Christmas Party. You know, I love, this is where the album, I think, starts taking a turn the other way. I love the audio clip from the TV series that leads into it. If you're an REM fan, I bet you love this song because it's very REM-ish. don't like REM. You're not happy about it. It's not a great song until the tempo picks up and the tambourine comes in, and then it gets better. It actually gets better, and then it gets bad again and better. So, you know, it's a little clangy for me, but it's good. It's not just up to the par of the prior five songs, which I think are, it should have been an EP. It should have been had those five songs on it, right? Plastic EP.
A plastic EP.
I'm already an EP. That's all right. Now, listen, can you just do a quick Davy Jones for us? How you do it, Santa style? Daydream Believer, just sing two lines. Yeah, that's it. Get people in the groove.
The Christmas as it sings. Natalie,
thanks, you're Santa. Go back to feeding your reindeers. That's fantastic.
All right, so Christmas Party. This song has a lot of really nice reverb in it. There's a lot of the 1960s style in terms of vocals and the way they're playing the instruments. It sounds a little bit like Rain in terms of some of the riffs that are being played. But with a useful Christmas vibe. I love the acidy guitars. And to follow up what Charles Claus was saying here, I happen to enjoy REM, so I totally understand what he means by that. Where it has more of a ambient vibe to it overall. So this song is just another great track following up from the other tracks. So another good one.
Fantastic. What do you think, Fred?
Okay, I see you. Okay. Anyway.
Stay out of the ICU.
Yeah, I'll try. I'm doing my best.
I'll give you a head massage, Fred.
But it's a good song, but it's more of an album track. You know, it's like not a throwaway, but it's not a single. It's an album track. It's fun. I like the fact that it starts with Davy, that you can hear Davy from the Christmas, the Monkees Christmas episode. And if you only have the regular album of Christmas Party that doesn't have the bonus tracks, this is the only other song that has Davy on it. You know, on the regular, that's two Davy songs. And then this one where you hear his voice. If you got the CD, the Target CD with the bonus tracks or the Monkees Christmas Party extra plus record store day singles, you'll get Davy on those. But it's a nice little track. Again, it's an album track. It's not a major track per se, but it's a good song.
Fantastic. What do you think, Michael?
I like it. I never thought about the REM comparison until Charles said it, and I can sort of hear it in the production values. Not necessarily that it sounds like the kind of song they would write, but it sounds like it was produced by them. I enjoy it. I think it's a good song. It doesn't match up to the first four, but it's certainly listenable. It's something I have on my phone and I play quite often. It's a good song.
Great.
Mark.
There we go. And Mark, which is, he's going to move across. There you go, Mark.
What? Oh, whoa.
I had the heat on and I had to turn it off. I was dying here. I was like, do I do it now? And I goes, I'm going to do it. Anyway, Christmas Party. Yeah, I like it for all the reasons that everybody said so far. I am an REM fan. I saw them back in the 80s. And, you know, I was curious because, you know, I've been connecting it to Good Times. There's no Peter Buck composition on Good Times. I wonder if he tried or if this was just a latter day call out for new material. I don't know. So anyway, if anybody knows, let me know.
Fantastic. Now we're going to keep the songs moving. The next one's called Jesus Christ. Tell me about that one, Santa.
So at this point, I wondered if this was like a Mickey Christmas album. You know? It's nice. It's certainly not up to par with the other songs. Alex Chilton of Box Tops fame, you know, we credit him for this one. It's good and it's nice. But if the other five songs weren't so amazing, anyway, I'm not a big fan of it. It's just okay. Fred's going to love it anyway. Natalie?
Okay, so the song Jesus Christ, it had sort of a Birds vibe to me in terms of how it was produced. There's a lot of really nice reverb on the harmonies and the tambourine or Christmas bells. I'm not exactly sure which it is, but that sort of chime sound in the middle of the song is a really nice overall accent. It's a sweet touch, and the guitar sound, the way that the guitars are played, it kind of reminds me of a Nesmith produced song overall. So it's another pretty strong song in terms of melody.
I guess it's my turn now.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah, it's a good song. It's one of the only songs that really convey the true reasons for Christmas, that touch on the background of what Christmas is all about. It's a good song. Mickey sings it well, but I think this is where they could have interchanged it with one of Davies, and the one I would have picked would have been This Day in Bethlehem from the Davies Christmas album. If you're going to put a song that reflects the true reasons of Christmas, I think that song would have fit better than Jesus Christ. It's a good song, but I think This Day in Bethlehem would have fit even better. And we would have had a third Davy song in that album.
Me personally, I would have gone with Davy Jones' Dream Girl. Dream Girl, I love you.
But it's not a Christmas song.
I mean, you can rock it up like a Christmas song.
Jingle bells, yeah.
Oh, ho, ho. You can do an Elvis version. Oh, dream girl, I love you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's it. What do you think, Michael?
This was written by Alex Chilton, and he did it with his old band, Big Star. So it's an old cover that they're doing here instead of having another new song. I am not a Christian, so for me, when they have a Christmas song, it's got to have such good music that I love it, you know, despite the fact that the lyrics don't say anything to me. The problem with this song is the lyrics are just, Jesus was born today. Yeah, okay, we got it. You know, tell us something about him. You know, there's not much to it. So it's an okay song. It's nothing that makes me go, this is great. You know, I play it, but I'm not overly enthused about it.
Fantastic, Mark.
Well, the difference is I don't know Dolan's religious beliefs one way or the other. I've heard both. So I'm going to stay off that subject. But apparently, Alex Chilton wrote this as a very snarky, sarcastic song. So, on that note, it's kind of an interesting twist to take it. Now, I noticed Peter Buck also plays on this track, so he might have been like, "Yeah, you gotta do it," you know. So, who knows, you know? And yeah, lyric wise, it's a bit slight, you know. It could have had more, but I think overall, Dolan's does a good job with it, considering.
Oh, yeah.
But he's a little more sincere with it, unlike the Big Star version with, you know. So anyway, that's all I have to say.
Now, I've got to tell you, listen to this. This is true. The next song, number 80, says it's called I Wish It Could Be Christmas Eve. But let me tell you, here in Australia, it actually is Christmas Eve. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow is Christmas Day. So just to tell you, it's, what is it?
He comes to us from the future.
It's 1 p.m. in the afternoon. Now, wait a minute. It's 1 p.m. in the afternoon. Tomorrow's Christmas Day. I've been invited to a relative for Christmas dinner, and I got my wife behind me telling me we've got to go and buy Christmas shopping. So let's keep the show going. What do you think of it, Santa?
So this is a song that I've been playing for many years as a DJ. I love the original version. Roy Wood, you know, ELO, The Move. recorded it with Wizard, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
And it rocks. I mean, it's, wow. It doesn't even sound like it's a Christmas song, but of course it is. So we're back to fun Christmas songs. I don't think it's as good as the original. And, you know, it that bothers me a little more here than like Nesmith doing the Christmas song. And when we get to Wonderful Christmas Time, that bothers me even more. But anyway, it's good. It's okay. And it may be introducing people to a song that they might not have heard. So it gets props for that. But, you know, if there's that six-song EP, maybe that's the sixth song. But I like it. I'm just not crazy about it because of the original. Natalie, had you ever heard this before?
I know I must have heard another version of this particular song. Not necessarily the movie's version, but I know I've heard other versions of this particular song. But I do like the way that they approached this one, considering the direction that they went in overall. It has a bit of a Let It Be vibe in terms of the chord structure at the end of the chorus. Because it kind of goes up, do, 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 do. And I recognize that particular melody at that point. It has there's a lot of really pretty echoes on the harmony, a lot of pretty harmonies in general. It's at certain points kind of reminded me a bit of 8 Days a Week in terms of the melodic structure. But overall, I like the approach that they took. And I thought that it was a good cover of a, I guess you would consider it a classic holiday song. So overall, I enjoyed it.
Great. Fred, come on in.
Yes. I like the original versions, like the one by Wizard. And I've heard different versions by Sarah Brightman, and Cheap Trick had covered it, and a lot of other people. Cheap Trick have it on their Christmas album. That's the name of the album, Christmas. But the Monkees version is good. Mickey does a good job on it. It's not that far different in the melody from the previously recorded versions, but it's a fun song. Like Charles says, it's a fun Christmas song. It's good to have another fun Christmas song on the album, you know, because you want to keep up the merriment. And this is a very merry song. And I would suggest looking up the original video by Wizard, the first ones that had the hit with it. That's a weird video. So you gotta see that one.
Michael.
I think this is bring the album back up again. It was starting to go downhill for me, and this pushes it back up. Not as high as the beginning, but it's a fun song. They do a really good cover of it. I'm not as familiar with the original versions, although I have heard them. I haven't played them as often as Charles has. But this is a very good version that I like quite a bit, and I wish they would pick more of those kinds of songs as opposed to, you know, Silver Bells or the ones we've heard 100 times.
Good call.
Right, come on in, Mark.
In a certain respect, I actually like this version better than the original, but I like the original a lot, mainly because of length. They actually shave off a whole minute, so it actually is a little more compact, and it makes it a little bit sharper tune that way, because the Wizard one, just you think it's over, and it keeps going and going, and it's about 5 minutes long.
No, so, if you're a DJ at a party...
Oh yeah, well, it's a good party.
The bathroom song.
Yeah, I know.
But yeah, I like both of them, and the video is very weird. Go watch it once you get off the show.
I will.
Is that it? Okay, now the next track I've got it here on the list. It's called Silver Balls. Actually, hang on, I've made a mistake. It's actually called Silver Bell, sorry, I apologize. All right, moving on. What do you think of Silver Bells there, Charles?
Well, for the same reason that maybe the Nesmith Christmas song shouldn't have been on there, because it's an overused song. And, you know, if you go with I Wish It Could Be Christmas Every Day, you're going with a more obscure song. So I get it. I agree with that more so with Silver Bells. It's just by the number. It's pretty. It's beautiful. I love Davey. I love him singing it. But it's so by the numbers that you wonder why. And I guess it's because it was available and, you know, they're able to reproduce it nicely and, you know, and bring up the production of it. I like it. It's beautiful, but it It's just by the numbers. I'm going to just repeat myself.
Fantastic. Nellie, come on in.
Silver Bells. Okay. So if the Monkees did have to do a cover of Silver Bells, I'm glad that Davey was given the lead to do the vocals. I found this to be a gorgeous, authentic rendition of the song, paying homage to the original. And in terms of how he does it, Davey definitely sings with emotion as if he's on stage, given that he has Broadway training. And I love the addition of the violins throughout the song at different points, giving a nice sense of ambiance. Overall, it's just a beautiful, authentic rendition of Silver Bells. And I enjoyed it quite a bit. So
I bet Fred, you the beautiful Natalie. Come on, Fred.
Fred doesn't like it as much as you.
I like it. I do.
It's a
good song. It originally was done by Bing Crosby and introduced in the movies by Bob Hope in the movie The Lemon Drop Kid. So, which I'm going to watch later on. It's a good rendition. I agree with Natalie. Davey sings it with nice emotion. I think
he also sings the day she falls in love with nice emotion too.
There you go. But he doesn't sing that song. He talks it.
You should put that on this album.
But going to the new remix of the Davy Jones Christmas album, show that again, Mark. There is a version on there that's been remixed, which has background vocals by Coco and I think Mickey and Annabelle Jones. So, and that I think adds a lot. And it's too bad again that the Monkees at the time of when this album was being put together, they couldn't, like Mickey couldn't have added his vocals on it back then. They should have, and I guess time constraints kept them from doing so. So the best they can do is remix it a little bit. But I think the one on the Davy Jones Christmas album is a little better because of the addition of Mickey and Coco. But the song is nice. It's a nice little song. It's a standard. And, you know, what else was there to say?
That's nice. That's very nice. Michael, what do you think?
Charles says something that reminded me of what bothers me about covers sometimes, in that if I'm going to hear someone do a cover, I want a different version. I don't want them to just put their vocals on a version I've heard 1,000 times. And that's the problem with this. And talking about Weezer put out a cover album last year that sounded like they were any other cover band. They just covered the songs exactly like the original were, and I was very disappointed. You know, I want to hear something new and different, and that's the problem with this song. It's not new and different. Davey does a great job, but it brings me to a question, though. Why isn't Christmas Is My Time of Year on this album? Why is it just an extra thing? That should have been on the album. If nothing else, the only two songs that have more than one monkey on them were the extras, you know, and that doesn't make sense to me. It seems like they should have been on the album. I wish they had put that instead of this.
Great point.
Right, Mark, come on in from Elfland.
I know, I'm looking up something. Did you know that the writer of this song actually wrote the Mr. Ed theme song? Anyway.
A horse is a horse, of course.
Of course. Of course. Of course.
A horse is of course, of course, of course. Yeah. That is, unless
the famous Mr. Ed.
Okay, let's rein that in.
The same stuff that everybody else said. I will say this about its original appearance in The Lemon Drop Kid. It's kind of an odd film to have that song suddenly come out of nowhere, and then it becomes a successful Christmas song years later. But, you know, hey, whatever. If I was to pick a second track off of Davey's Christmas album, which I keep holding up, I don't know if I'd pick this one. Because it's kind of a little, you know, and Davey kind of owns it. It sounds like a solo track when you do that. I would have rather had Rocking Around the Christmas Tree to just kind of
I thought the same thing.
Energy up on the album, you know, because, you know, it's almost like because Davey's gone, they can pigeonhole him and say, oh, he's the balladeer, you know, and it's like, no, he could sing all sorts of things, you know. Show that it's a Monkees album with a variety of different things. Even put The Day We Fall in Love. No.
Let's not go though with that far.
But well, like I say, while everybody's monkeying around, let's move on to the next track, which is Wonderful Christmas Time. Obviously, the Paul McCartney song.
Who wrote that? Who wrote this?
Who writes this stuff?
Who wrote
what
this?
What do you think of the song? Very the quickly. Version.
The song by Paul McCartney is phenomenal. Come on, what are you talking about? It's like one of the best Christmas songs ever written. I love Paul McCartney. Why, Mickey? If you do a Beatles song, do Oh Darling. Great. Don't do Wonderful Christmas Time. It's like Davy's jingle. It's a karaoke song. Mickey's doing karaoke here. Davy on Jingle Bells karaoke. It's this song on this album just spoils the album for me, and I'm sorry to say it because Mickey sings it well. It's a good version. I just think I don't know, man.
Don't get started.
You really think, Charles? Come on.
Don't get Charles started. What do you think, Natalie?
Okay, so up front, because I've heard varying opinions on the original. I have listened to the original Wonderful Christmas Time regularly every holiday. It's one of my favorites. I adore it. Paul is my favorite Beatle. I just want to qualify that right now. Now, in terms of the cover, I was actually impressed with the amount of care that was taken into producing it overall. The instrumentation does capture the original mood very well. There's a rolling rhythm. It's a really nice adaptation of the original, and one thing that I do appreciate about this particular cover is the addition of strings in addition to everything else involved with the song. Overall, I think it's just a nice homage. It's a beautiful homage to such a great Christmas classic. So I was actually pretty impressed by this one.
Fantastic. Let's move on to Fred. That's flashing. You're flashing, Fred.
Come on, Fred. Be honest. Fred, be honest.
I love the original Paul McCartney one. There. So, but I like Mickey's too. I like the version that's on this album. I think
of course you do, Fred.
Mickey does a fine job with it. It would have been great if it was a different song, but I mean, you didn't do Happy Christmas War's Over, so you know there is a Monkees version of that.
Really?
That would have been interesting.
But I like this version. I think I like the fact that they do. There's a slight difference in the arrangement, a little bit. It's not that much. It's still enough. You recognize the song, but they did something with the arrangement. I think helps a little bit more. And I like the way it ends. I think Natalie used to say about the end, how it ends, how they did a little difference on it.
Yeah, I did notice that it was a bit different in terms of how they approached the end on this one versus the original. Because the original, there's sort of a denouement where there's this...
you're using words on this.
There's an extended chord. But in addition to that, there's this sort of chime sound that sort of reverberates out.
Uh-huh. But yeah, I agree with that. And it's a good version of the song. I mean, I wish it had been a different song they could have used or an original song, but it's a nice version. It makes a nice sound. A nice sandwich.
Fantastic. What do you think, Michael?
I always thought Paul's version was just not that well produced. I mean, he played all the instruments. Charles is watching me very closely here. I think this is the production. I like the music in this one better. I like the performance better in this one, I should say, than Paul's version. It's an okay song. It's nothing great. You know, I don't fall over for it. I think I would have liked it if the Monkees had picked something else a little more obscure. But it's okay. I do like the music better in this one than the original one. Let's put it that way. You know, the musicianship. And I'm a huge Paul McCartney fan, as everyone knows. Sorry.
Does everyone know that this was actually Paul McCartney's first solo single? Now you said, what? He had 10 years? Yeah, but it's the first one that actually is labeled Paul McCartney.
I'll have to go back and look at that.
And Maybe I'm Amazed was not released as a single way back when. It was later, but you know, it's like, and then when they did release it originally, it was the Wings Live version. So anyway.
This is Paul, and all the instruments. Paul plays every instrument on this song.
He recorded it for the McCartney 2 sessions.
Right.
Didn't put it on the album. And then the video has wings in it, so go for it. Anyway, and then now there's McCartney 3. I had to plug it in here. So I got the McCartney 3 vinyl. So I had to finally get a vinyl. Anyway,
can I ask you how many years McCartney 3 are at? Is it about 2000?
Just came out like 3 days ago.
Yeah, 3 days ago.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about every version that comes out, whether it's green, red, whatever. How many of those versions are out there?
Yeah. About the green
74.
This is again the plain old black vinyl version. See, boring black vinyl.
So boring.
That's classic.
And I'm getting the Japanese version because it has 4 extra tracks, but wow. I don't have it yet.
Let's see the back cover.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, cool.
Oh, fantastic. Okay.
No plug for that. Okay, but I like this. I like this better than the original one because the problem with McCartney's version always was all that damn synthesizer stuff. Yes. It's like he could re-record it with a better instrumentation. And he has, but he had like the Roots with him and Jimmy Fallon and everything like that. It's like, no, just do a third a version with your own orchestra. Anyway, so Mickey kind of covers for that. So that's why I like this version. Anyway.
I agree. You see,
one I agree. Saturday Night Live some years ago with Tom Short.
Yes.
That's such a fun.
That's a single too. So.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Come on in now with the next song, Snowfall, Charles. If you can see.
Snowfall is not a Christmas song, guys.
It isn't?
It's not a Christmas song. It's a winter song.
Yeah, just like Jingle Bells.
And Winter Wonderland.
What's wrong with that?
Yeah, but those songs are so standardized that they're associated with Christmas. This one is boring. It's a nice enough Nesmith vocal, but it puts me to sleep, and it's the worst song on the album. And I know Natalie's going to disagree because of Mike Nesmith, but Fred's going to agree with me. You'll see. Okay, Natalie, go ahead.
Okay, so this one ended up being my favorite on the album.
I knew it.
It immediately. Oh, stop that! Stop that!
Stop beating anyway, up on the girl.
It immediately has a snowy mood upon the first couple of notes. Of course, it's another Nesmith, so immediately I was drawn to it. Loved it instantly when I first heard it. The harmonies are just beautiful. It's got a 1940s. It feels like it could have been recorded in the 1940s with a full orchestra on stage. It definitely has that vibe. It is my favorite song on the album. I just love the way that it's produced. It's just full of gorgeous harmonies. And just in terms of vocals and arrangement, it's got a timeless and gorgeous overall vibe to it, kind of like the song At Last, which I've also heard a wonderful cover of by the Black Ties. It has that kind of vibe to me, but it immediately put me in mind of a snowy landscape overall. Like you could hear this being played as snow is falling, and that's what I love about it. So maybe it's not necessarily a Christmas song, but it's definitely a winter song, and I tend to really enjoy, you know, songs from that entire genre, just in terms of holiday, but overall, favorite song on the track, overall.
Charlie D, where are you when we need you?
All I got to say is, oh, yeah, baby.
Oh, yeah.
I got to tell you, I told you before, the two greatest songs for Christmas for me are Santa Bring My Baby Back to Me. And the other one, Blue Christmas. Oh, Blue Christmas without you.
My turn.
Right.
Natalie, I'm glad you caught that about Snowfall sound like a 40s song because it was recorded in the 40s. It was written about that. It's an old standard. And hearing Nesmith's version was the first time I heard it.
Wow.
And then I found out later that it was an old standard. Way back when. It's not necessarily a Christmas song, just like Winter Wonderland.
Yeah.
And Jingle Bells are not necessarily Christmas songs, but they lend themselves to the season. And I think the same thing goes with Snowfall. And Nesmith does a great job singing it. And it's a nice arrangement. And it's nice to hear a song that introduced that you've never heard before by an artist that you like. And then you find out, oh, this is an older song. So absolutely. I might want to I might want to check out the other versions, which I've done. I like them. I think Doris Day has done this song.
Wow. So, okay.
So it's definitely a song worth checking out just for its history. And I like the fact that Nesmith helped to reintroduce it to people out there.
Next.
The fact that it sounds like a 1940 song means that it doesn't sound like a Monkees song. And that kind of bothers me quite a bit. You know, this should be a Monkees album, not a covers of old songs from 100 years ago or whatever. So other than that, I agree with Charles. It puts me to sleep.
Fantastic. What do you think, Mark?
I think you wouldn't have had Nesmith if you didn't let him choose these things. That's my honest opinion. Otherwise, he wouldn't be on the album. So he had to kind of bend over for him that way. Yeah, but a lot of people have done good song versions of this. Check out Tony Bennett's version. Let's see, who else? Anyway, a lot of people. Look on the Wikipedia page under Claude Thornhill, who's the writer, and it says all the people who have done versions of this song. And it even says the Monkees on there, so hey. Do I like it? Yeah, it's okay. I don't know if it belongs on this or any Monkees album or any album, Christmas album, but you know, like I said, you wouldn't have a Nesmith on here if you didn't let him pick his own songs. That's cool. Really.
Do I like it? I like it. I like it. I like the way you run your fingers through my head. Right. Back to the show. Fantastic. Next track. Now, is this the correct title there, Fred? Number 12 is Angels We Have Heard on High. Is that right?
Yes. Right. Yes.
Correct. Do you understand the meaning of that title? Like, I'm trying to get
high, not while high. On high, not wild high.
On high.
What do you think of it, Charles?
I'm just glad to have a Peter track. It's not a good vocal by Peter. You know, you listen to him sing Till Then, and wow, that's his range. My God, that's, you know, he hits that so perfectly. Here, he's trying to, it's not, he sounds, I don't like it. It sounds, begins, the plucking in the beginning sounds more oriental than it does Christmas. It gets better when Peter, you know, picks his banjo faster. You know, it picks up. It makes it a little interesting. But I guess we had to have a Peter song, and I'm glad we do. Just, wish it was better.
Natalie.
Okay, Natalie.
Okay, so this is an old standard, Angels We Have Heard on High. There's been many covers of it. This one is a lot of fun to listen to. We have Peter singing lead. The first thing I noticed was the banjo. and I did really enjoy that little addition. I wouldn't have necessarily pictured a banjo to go with this song, but it works here. Especially with his vocals, they kind of match each other in a way. It's got a very playful vibe overall. It's got a very folky overall approach, which is a lot of fun. Upon listening to this, it kind of reminded me of a song that maybe the new Christy Minstrels would put together. And the funny thing is, upon listening to the new Christy Minstrels version, which is a little more straightforward, I expected them to take this approach a lot more, but Peter's ended up being more fun, more playful in comparison. But overall, it's just a very fun, enjoyable take on a classic.
There we go. My turn.
Okay. Fantastic. Fred, what do you think of it?
Love this song.
Wow. What a shocker.
Well, for many different reasons. I know for a fact that this is the very last song that Peter Tork recorded. He recorded in September of 2018. I think the banjo part was pre-recorded. It might be from the Beechwood Christmas CD there. And Peter recorded a new vocal for it because of what he was going through at the time. Mm-hmm. There's a reason there is the auto-tune. He obviously, his voice was not strong enough to really carry the song as well as he could have. I mean, yeah, he sounds great when he sang Till Then, but then he was in better voice and better health at the time he recorded that. We're hearing Peter Tork towards the end of his life. Hi, Jan. Nice to see you, sweetheart. But we're hearing Peter Tork towards the end of his life. He wanted to give the fans a final gift. This song, I'm going to cry now. This song is a gift.
Don't cry too much.
We have to. I am going to cry. We have to appreciate this song, what it is from Peter Tork. It is a gift, and we should appreciate it for that. Thank you, Peter.
Okay, hats off. Hats off.
Follow that.
It is hard to hear this song without getting sad for Peter, because you know he was struggling at the time he was recording it, and he chose this for his reasons, which I don't know. So if I didn't know anything about Peter or the band or anything else like that, though, I would say this doesn't fit on the album for the same reasons I said some of the other classics don't fit on the album. But I want a Peter song, obviously. It's hard for me to listen to it because it makes me sad. Once more, I don't think it fits, but I'm certainly not going to tell him it shouldn't be on the album.
Mark.
Well, yes, it is the same version. I listened to it on this Beechwood Christmas, which has a bunch of other tracks. It's not a complete Peter Tork album. There's only like two tracks that are really Peter on here, if I remember correctly. And yeah, The Angels We Have Heard on High is complete banjo instrumental, which is very interesting. Oh. It was recorded probably, I'm going to say, there's no date on here, and it's in the book somewhere, about 10 or 15 years ago, something like that. So that was probably part of the reason he chose it, because he said, you know, I can just overlay a vocal on this and not exert too much effort. I mean, he'd already retired from the group from touring. He wasn't doing interviews. I was actually kind of shocked and surprised he ended up in the album for that reason. You know, I was saying, how are they going to get him on here? Oh, I guess he's on Christmas that time of year. You know, it was my time of the year. So he's on there de facto, even though he's not really singing lead. But yeah, he made a valiant effort and then was gone, what, 6 months later or less? You know, something like that, you know. So kudos to Peter.
Yes, Peter.
All right.
I just came on without my glasses.
It's like being naked.
Exactly.
It's like being plastic.
You'll be
kind of. Let me tell you, this is the last song on the album. So what I want you to do is talk about the last song and do a summation of the whole album, what you think of it.
Well, are we going to do the bonus tracks too?
Please.
Will you, Fred?
Yes, the bonus tracks are better than some of the other ones.
How many bonus tracks are there?
Two.
There's two bonus
tracks. Okay, we'll do the bonus tracks.
Charles.
Yeah.
Merry Christmas, baby, not ball gag.
Got you. Oh,
hey, Charles, make sure you don't swallow that. You don't want to spend all day at the hospital. Now, Merry Christmas, baby. What do you think of it? Charles, I'll let you take over for a minute.
Yeah, so it's bluesy. It's sultry. It's Mickey's sexy voice. You know, he starts real that way. And then he goes into his R&B rocking voice. You know, it sounds like it could have been recorded in Sun Studios. It's a Elvis. We've been, you know, alluding to Elvis all day. And this has got that Elvis. Carl Perkins, you know, that kind of beat and the kind of feel. I bet he loved singing this song. You know, it's a nice closer to the album. It's certainly not, you know, Wrap You for Christmas. It's not as good as the other songs, but it's okay. It fits. And I'm glad it's on here. So many reasons why I think the two bonus tracks should have been on as normal tracks. I agree with everybody on that. And hi, Jennifer. Oh, my God. Great to see you.
Love you, Jen.
Very good. Natalie, hi. Tell us.
All right. So the song Merry Christmas, Baby. So this is one of my favorites. I've listened to it from a very young age onwards. And this is a very good cover to close out the main album. And it's just authentic in every sense of the word. It's got a very bluesy, sort of grungy vibe to it overall. And I think it's a nice closer to the entire main album. So in addition to that, just the entire album itself is just full of fun originals and covers focused around the holiday. And some of them maybe more around just season, not necessarily the holiday itself. But overall, it's just a fun time all around.
I guess my turn, I guess.
Yeah.
Yes. I love the original song. I've heard different versions of it. I think Bruce Springsteen did it too, right? I believe.
Yes, yeah. He did.
I heard the Bruce Springsteen version. And I think Chuck Berry, is it a Chuck Berry tune or?
No, it's older than Chuck
it's,
Berry.
Elvis. Elvis,
like
I know.
Warren Lou Baxter.
Right. But Elvis has done it. I've heard Elvis's and I love his.
Yeah.
And Mickey does a great job. And I agree. It's very bluesy. It's right up his alley. And I think this was one of the songs he did perform live in his Christmas show. I believe he did. Hopefully that video turns up. But I believe he did perform that song live. And this is an obvious song that Mickey loves. And he does a great job with it. And it's a good way to close off the main album, as I agree, as you guys have said.
I agree. It's a good closer. Mickey, you can just see Mickey smiling. I mean, you know he loved singing this. You can tell his enthusiasm is in it. It's a good way to end the album. It's a classic, but it's not such a big classic like Silver Bells that you've heard too many times. So I think it's a good one to choose. Still doesn't sound that Monkees-like. But it fits. It fits. It's a good closer.
Good. Very good.
Hey, Mark.
It's strange you say that because a lot of people have covered it. I mean, Otis Redding and Sheryl Crow and Chuck Berry and blah, blah, blah. But it still sounds fresh. So I'll give it that, you know. And if they didn't have the bonus tracks, I still would have ended the album with this, you know, and put the other two tracks somewhere else in the mix. Mm-hmm. Which we'll talk about soon. So overall, I like it. You know, it didn't end on a too much of a downer, you know, which they could have with this album, you know, because it's the very disparate productions and source material and things like that. So anyway.
So I think Plastic has gone shopping for Christmas, so we can continue with the other two bonus songs.
Okay, the first one is Ryuchiu.
I think that this should have closed the album, actually. I think this would have been a great album closer. It's an amazing a cappella song written for four vocals. The harmonies are pristine, immaculate, perfect. Loved it when I heard it originally. Still love it now. It's still fresh. And you pop that in and people are like, really? It's wow. And I just want to say something, a quick plug. This artwork that was changed, this mock-up commissioned Monkees thing, is actually on auction right now on Monkees Marketplace. So if anyone wants to buy this actual one, you can get it there. I love the song. And it's, you know, just to have a cappella and to hear all those voices so beautifully and clearly, it just brings me joy. And it was Natalie, had you heard this before, this album?
Actually, when I listened to the album itself, I did not find the bonus tracks. But from what you're describing, it sounds really fascinating. So I definitely want to take a listen, probably after the discussion, to both of the tracks that were bonus on the album. Based on what you're describing, though, it sounds like something that I would definitely be drawn to overall in terms of the way you're describing the four-part harmonies, that is definitely something I'm fascinated by. So,
Natalie, have you seen the Monkees Christmas episode?
Actually, I've heard about it, but I don't think I've had a chance to actually watch it.
But they do sing Ryuchiu at the very end of the...
Oh, okay.
I'm sure it's on the internet somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
yeah, you'll find it.
Undoubtedly.
Anyway, my turn. Let you know, on the vinyl version of the album, it is the final track.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, okay.
Yes,
and it is on the Record Store Day Monkey Christmas Party Plus with the other bonus tracks on there. I've always loved this incredible song. When I first heard it, I thought, wow, these guys, you know, hi Doug, hello, hi there. People who say that the Monkees are talented have to hear this song because it's just them. You go. It's just them singing a cappella. And it's just amazing. When I did my Christmas CD, I started it with a version of Ryuchiu, and I ended it with the other bonus track we're going to talk about. But don't get Charles started. The Target CD has both bonus tracks on that. So it's worth searching this one out. But it's always been one of my favorite Monkee tunes. I'm glad it's officially on a It's been officially released on some like Missing Links, and as a bonus track on one of the box sets, or I think it's on the deluxe edition of Pisces, but not there's no box set yet for Pisces. Just there was a deluxe edition, and I think it's on there. And I'm glad it's on this official Christmas album, and I'm glad that it is available on the vinyl of the album, so people could at least, if they find the vinyl, they'll be able to hear that song. Michael.
I was very frustrated this wasn't put on the main album, because it's the only song that has all four monkeys on it. I mean, you know, every song on the regular album has only one monkey, you know, and then the two bonus tracks, this one has four, the other one has three. You know, come on, they should have been on the main album. It's a wonderful, beautiful song. It would have been a great closer. I wish they had used this. It would have fit on the vinyl. I mean, come on, you know, the vinyl was only like 20 minutes.
It is on the vinyl.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Well, it wasn't on the CD. Except the Target CD, which I have, so I'm not sure, but I don't think it was on the original CD.
No. And
it has plenty of room. Come on, more room than vinyl. You know, they could easily fit it on.
Yeah.
Right. Mark.
I'm one of these weirdos who thinks that they should have opened the album with this, because
I agree.
You know, just kind of, you know, get you in the mood, and you know, and then kind of gradually go up into more rocking stuff, you know, then you could have your Silver Bells, because you could have that like as a second song or something like that, and then, you know, get to the meatier stuff. But I know, you know, they try to put the hit at first, you know. I get it. Okay.
Well, I actually started my Christmas CD with Ryuchiyo, because
hey, you did it right, Fred. See?
I did it right, because I wanted it to be like my Our Prayer, like the Beach Boys Smile. I wanted it to start that way, and I saw it as Our Prayer. But that's why I put that the first song on my CD. Anyway.
Now, I kind of wish, because they had room, that they might not have gotten the rights for it. I mean, the TV episode, The Christmas Show, that has Butch, Eddie Munster, Patrick in it, they not only sing Ryuchi, but they also do a funny version of Deck the Halls, which would have been a funny bonus track.
Right.
And also, in the 80s, All Four Monkeys were together, although Michael really didn't sing, on the MTV Christmas, whatever it was, and like a medley of hits, and they should have put that on here, too.
I was at the studio for it.
Make a double album. Come on. Anyway, but yes, Ryuchi must be on this album. At least it got on the vinyl. Get the Target version. Forget all the other versions. And it has to be on your album. Okay.
Fred, is your CD still available for the holidays?
Who?
Is your CD still available for the holidays?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. You guys can still get it.
How many copies you got left for it? Be honest.
A bag full.
Everyone should have his album and his two books. Everyone.
Thank you.
We got one more. Buy volume two, Plastic EPs on page 206. Buy the book, rip my page out, and throw the book away.
All right, one more song to go.
We got one more track.
One more song to go.
All right, what's the track, Michael?
Christmas is my time of year.
All right, listen, as we go through it, do a summation on the album, please. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Go Santa.
I love the song, and I'm glad it's on here. You know, good monkey song. Nothing to talk about, but the whole album, God, it's you know, it's double fantasy. Half the album is great.
Charlie! Hey, Charlie, you got something wrong with your microphone. It's echoing.
Hey, you know
what I reckon? I won't let him back on.
No, that was enough.
No.
That was enough.
He's not really in the Christmas spirit.
But if you bring him back, we have to go through all the songs again.
No, we don't. But I'll tell you what, if he comes on and he's got a microphone problem, bye-bye, Jack.
As I said, I love the first, you know, five songs or whatever, plus a few others. It was made an unbelievable EP. I wish all the songs, I had an album and vinyl, I wish all the great ones were on one side, so I never have to flip it over. I'm grateful. I'm grateful we have a Monkees album. And had that not been the first five songs and they only did covers, you know, we'd be happy. You know, we're spoiled because those songs are so amazing, you know. Unwrap You for Christmas is a classic. It's beyond great. And same with What Would Santa Say? So I love the album because of those songs. So the ones that are weaker, don't diminish it for me. But wow, could this have been like one of the greatest albums in history? Next.
Okay, so I am going to take a listen to the two bonus tracks sometime after this, considering that the list of tracks that I took a listen to didn't include those, so I will go find them after this. Aside from that, it's a really nice arrangement of both originals from the Monkees and really authentic covers of classics and, you know, classic standards and what would be considered modern classics in the case of Wonderful Christmas Time. In the case of my favorite, Snowfall, I had no idea that that was a cover of a 1940s tune. So that's a nice little bit of information to know. I think that the way that they arranged that particular song really does the original justice. I just love that one overall. There's a little bit of everything on this album in terms of holiday music. There's some Monkees tunes, there's some classic arrangements that pay homage to the original, and some are just fun and playful. In the case of Angels We Have Heard on High, Silver Bells, there's a lot of just really fun, enjoyable songs, but there's also some really faithful recreations done with a Monkees flair to it. So overall, there's something for everybody on this album, and I found it quite enjoyable considering I didn't know that this existed. I didn't know there was a Christmas album by the Monkees. It was my first time listening to it, but it definitely, there are a lot of really strong songs on this album overall. So I think I might listen to it again after this for sure.
Okay. Anyway.
Kathy, who's next?
Yay.
The bonus track is Christmas Is My Time of Year, the last one that's on the Target CD. Unfortunately, it's not on the vinyl album, but it is on the Record Store Day double singles. And there goes Elfman. Elfman! the original single came out in 1976. It was later reissued, remixed by Chip Douglas in 86. And this is where this picture sleeve came from. The original did not have a picture sleeve.
Oh, I didn't know.
But it's... it's a great tune. It has three Monkees. It's got Mickey, Davey, and Peter. The first time we had the three keys. I'm sorry. I take that back. The first time we had the three keys was 69 with Nez. That's right. Hello. Hi, Doug. Nice to see you. The Doug Bill Last stepson. Oh, hi. Give Bill Last our regards, please. Anyway, it's a great tune. I wish it was on the regular vinyl, and I wish it was on the regular CD, but I'm glad it's on the Target CD. And as I mentioned, I did cover it on my Christmas CD, and I made that the last tune.
Yeah.
So I started with Ryuchiyu, ended it with Christmas Is My Time of Year, and Charlie's heard it.
Fred, right? Fred, what's your least favorite song on the album?
The album in general. I like the album. I think it's a good follow-up to Good Times. It's not particularly Good Times 2. It's just a different album. If I was to take a song off the album, it would be Jesus Christ, but I would replace it with This Day in Bethlehem by Davey, so we can at least have another Davey track on there. And I wish they had added, besides that, the two Davey tracks that are on there, they should have been more representation from Davey. And there is a song by Peter that should have been on this album, I Remember Christmas. And it was a song he put out. I don't know if it's on the it's on the Beechwood album, Mark. I Remember Christmas.
Yes.
All right. That song should have been on this album too. And it's a nice little song, and it's a nice nostalgic song. And they could have had two Peter tracks, but I guess they had to go with what they had. Remember, the year this album was being recorded, we had we almost had a near tragedy with Mike Nesmith that we almost lost him because of his heart condition. And Peter, of course, was going through what he was going through. So the fact that this album even got made is a miracle. So overall, I love this album. It's a great Christmas present. And like I said, Peter's track in particular is a gift. So, Michael.
Thank you, Fred.
Christmas is
Thank you. Who's next?
Me. Christmas
okay,
is,
go for it.
Is one of my favorites. It's written by Howard Kalin from the Turtles and Chip Douglas, who, of course, produced the Monkees. And
Ed Gordis.
It's on the Turtles CD with all their singles, their original
version. Briefly a turtle himself.
And one of the, Chip Douglas was a turtle himself for a while. But one of the things that I like about it is that it is not the song you hear all the time. I wish they had replaced, you know, Silver Bells or something with this, because one of the things I like about this album are the new songs. And for many people who have never heard this song before, it would be a new song. I wish it was on there. It's a good production. It's got three of the Monkees on it. Why wouldn't you want it on the album? It's just so frustrating to me that it's not there. As far as the album in total, I agree with Charles that it's the double fantasy. Half of it's really great, and half of it is like, I can take it or leave it. And mostly leave it. I know that you like Snowfall, but that's still not really a Christmas song to me. And I know you say it feels like the season, but, you know, ask Plastic how much snow they get in the Southern Hemisphere. You know, you're being elitist, the Northern Hemisphere elitist there.
Well, we did get snow.
Yeah, we got lots of snow.
He didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just want to say, what a fantastic show, Charlie.
Wait a minute. You shipped me around so I don't forget to talk.
Mark. Sorry, Mark, come on.
Okay, Christmas is my time of year. Yeah, there's a great version that's hard to find, but it's on a few compilations that has two of the Turtles, Mark Volman and Howard Kalin, and Linda Ronstadt. And so it's not listed under the Turtles, but it's on some Turtle CD too.
Natalie, can you duck so I can see him a little clearer, please?
So which version is better? It's a toss-up. I really like both of them. But, you know, I'll kind of give the nod to the Monkees because Chip got three of them together at a time where it looked like they would never get together ever again. Anyway, so good way to end the album. I don't know why he had to remix it and remaster it. And you know, the original versions on the CD, the original versions on the 7-inch thing, EP, and the remixes on this. And it also appeared on a CD called A TV Family Christmas, if you want to look up that, which has Buck Owens doing Santa Look a Lot Like Daddy. Anyway.
That's all I'm going to say. Now, listen, Charlie, can you say Merry Christmas to everybody?
The album. So I love the album. It's better than Just Us. It's better than Pull It. It's not as good as Good Times, but, you know, it's a good addition, and I'm glad we have it. You know, okay. We should all be glad.
I'm suggesting everybody at home play it now. Charlie D, say Merry Christmas to everyone.
Merry Christmas to everyone.
Hey, perfect.
Hey. Let me ask you guys a question since I've got you here.
Okay.
The last show started with the Monkees committing suicide by jumping off a bridge. And was just miserable and abysmal. And this album is so happy and joyful. I say this is a much better album than Head.
Agreed.
Okay. Yeah. Can I say something? After
this
show,
that's why you went to the last show.
What's that movie that Disney puts out about the pirates?
Well, let me tell you, Fred, everybody loved well, except for Charles. Thank God for Charles for having an opinion that's other than everything's great.
Well, now, I even thought that about
Head. There's some terrible stuff about that Head album in that movie. Abysmal.
Nope.
Hey, Charlie, I gotta say, you look like a pirate. You look like you're going on the set of that Disney movie.
I am.
Pirates of the Caribbean. You look like you're going to be on the next.
I'm the Christmas pirate.
Hey, wait, Charles, Charlie, are you?
Wait. Let's say something in all honesty here. Fred, I have to tell you, we thoroughly enjoyed that album, and my kids make my wife play the first track about six times on the way to school every morning. Nice. They absolutely love it and would love to actually talk to you about it at some point if you ever wanted to do a Zoom or something with them. It's been great. And Chipmunk Fun is my favorite Chipmunk song.
Can I interject something here? I got a real, these Christmas lights are from Davy Jones' original Christmas tree. Wow. These are personal, from his personal Christmas tree. I got these a couple years ago at the one of the monkey conventions for charity for his charity fund.
Wow.
So these are from his original Christmas tree. And one last thing, this Dino dinosaur here, this was the last Christmas gift my dad gave me before he passed away. Because he got me a Dino toy back in when I was a kid. And the last Christmas we had with him, he wanted to give all the kids a toy that they remembered most. I remembered the Dino. So he got me this.
That's beautiful. Hey, Plastic, let's thank Ron Dante for being part of the show. Let's ask everyone if they have a book that someone can still get for the holidays or for the New Year's to hold it up, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Right.
And Plastic, are we going to wish all our monkey fans out there watching the show a very happy, healthy, joyous holiday and New Year? And we'll all be back for 2021 for what? For which album? What's next?
Present.
Yeah. Finally, back to some good monkeys music.
The monkeys present. Now, let me say on behalf of everybody here, what a great show it's been. Thank you, Ron, for coming on. Ron Dante, thanks for texting us. Thanks, everybody. You know, Plastic EP album show with our fantastic panel. We all want to wish you a merry, merry Christmas. And we're all looking forward to 2021. So on behalf of everybody, have a merry Christmas.
What? We got to sing. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.